Bronx Box Office Season 2. I'm Greg.
And I'm Nicole.
And today we are talking about Everything Everywhere All at Once. This is a movie directed by the Daniels, Daniel Kwan and Daniel Scheinert. This movie's a trip. It's hard to kind of summarize, but I guess in short, it's a movie about a woman who's able to connect to every single alternate reality version of herself at once, hence the title. Mm-hmm. And yeah, this movie's like wild. What did you think about it?
Well, from a filmmaking point of view, that's like our major.
Yes, of course.
It's a lot.
It's a lot.
it's a lot to handle, and it's a lot to just comprehend in one sitting.
Yeah. I think like multiverse as a concept is kind of like getting a little more popular in pop culture, and this definitely reflects that. And it is like overwhelming, just like that concept. But like, it's done so well. Like there's not a lot of movies that talk about the multiverse, mm-hmm. but this is definitely my favorite I've seen. And I think a big part of that is because like there's all this crazy multiverse stuff happening, but like the story is just about this family. Like the main character, Evelyn, you know, she runs a failing laundromat, and her marriage is kind of falling apart with her husband. Her daughter is closing herself off. And the story through the multiverse adventure we get this like family story about them like coming together and accepting each other, and it's really sweet.
I was like, everything going on all at once, like I just said. Mm-hmm. There's still like a little story in it too. It's like a little mother-daughter story.
Yeah, it's got a great like emotional core.
Yeah, I almost cried. I almost actually cried.
I did cry.
Did you cry?
Yes. Like there were the ending, which I'm not going to spoil, but like I cried through the whole ending, and then yeah, there's just some really great emotional moments in this movie, and also some really funny moments in this movie, and also some awesome action stuff, which is something I wanted to talk about. Michelle Yeoh, who is the star of this movie, she's really well known for being a kick-ass action star, and that is. It's never been more true than it is here. Like the fight choreography is just like off the hook. They're so like environmental with stuff. Like set design is a very big thing in this, mm-hmm. and you see that the most in the fight scenes. They really take advantage of all that stuff, and they use that for a lot of humor too. Mm-hmm. Did you have like a favorite like scene from this movie that like stuck out to you?
Definitely one of the comedy parts. The hot dog fingers were a big part of that.
Yes.
It was just. It was the clicking of the fingers when they like hit together.
Yes.
Like I said, I don't want to spoil it.
Doesn't matter how many times I see it, I'm so.
Revolutionary branch.
I think that's a good example to like kind of explain the multiverse premise. So like in that alternate reality, everyone on Earth has hot dog fingers.
Yes.
They have just hot dogs for fingers. And Evelyn, instead of being married to her husband in that universe, is married to the IRS agent. That's kind of like an antagonist.
Right.
So like they play with a bunch of stuff with the different universes, like the character dynamics and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And that's really cool to see. But the hot dog fingers as a visual was so funny, mm-hmm. and them like hugging each other with these like big
like not even like normal hot dogs though, like
finger toned hot, like they look like fingers.
Yes.
But they're like it's just a lot.
What's
yeah
your favorite part about
for
it?
Me,
yeah,
I really love the humor in this, but like the scene that made me cry, we get an alternate universe of like if the main character had never married her husband, mm-hmm. and it turns out instead of being some like failing laundromat owner, she's like this crazy kung fu movie star, and is super successful, and we see how great her life is without her husband. And then there's this moment where she meets that other universe version of her husband.
The alpha one, right?
The,
like an alpha.
It's
alpha.
Like, well, that's like the alpha verse is the universe like going into other universe. It's so convoluted. It's so complicated. But in this universe, the one where she's a successful movie star, she meets who is her husband in other universes, and they have a really sweet moment. And I just like, that was my favorite stuff. Like they use the universes to like give us like character moments we wouldn't be able to get otherwise. Mm-hmm. You know, another example, which is a good comedy one, is when the mother and daughter are just rocks, and it's like a 3-minute scene of just two rocks sitting on a cliff, and all the dialogue is text on the screen.
Yeah.
But it's so effective, yeah. And what they're talking about is really impactful,
yeah.
Even though you're watching two rocks and text on screen.
Yeah, literally not doing nothing. And like, there's no music, there's no sound, there's no nothing.
Yep.
Just a rock and a rock, dialogue and a screen, and then eventually the rock gets closer.
Yes,
they play,
she
play
moves.
Picture, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that was really great. And I think that's a good place to bring up, like, the special effects in this movie and how
yes.
they kind of did that. This was, I'm not sure what the budget for this movie was, but I know, I'm not sure. The budget was around $25 million, according to Google.
Wow.
But a lot of the special effects were done by, like, self-taught VFX artists who, like,
okay.
taught themselves how to do it on YouTube. And you can, like, yeah, they literally trained themselves off YouTube tutorials and made this amazing movie. So this is the perfect example of you can teach yourself and do something of professional quality and really pull it off.
Wow.
And you can kind of see, like, when you're watching the effects, if you're familiar with that stuff, you can kind of tell, like, oh yeah, I can see that this was done by one person
mm-hmm.
or a handful of people just, like, in their bedroom, like, working on VFX. And that was really cool to me, like, the filmmaking aspect.
Having more of our program watch that, yes, please.
Yeah.
Yes.
For sure. I just generally recommend this,
yes.
but if you're into filmmaking at all, this is a great movie to watch.
Yes.
Because you can really see, you really get a good sense of how it's made just by watching it. And it's just like, it's really exciting. Like, you finish the movie and you're like, oh man, like, I could do something like that. Maybe not this great, but something close enough. So yeah, we definitely recommend Everything Everywhere All at Once.
Every possibility
from
All right, so now we're going to talk about a movie called Greener Grass. Like Everything Everywhere All at Once, this is also a wild ride, but for some different reasons. This is a movie directed by Jocelyn DeBoer and Dawn Loeb, and it is very surreal, I guess. It's about this this woman who lives in this like hyper-fantasy suburban neighborhood, and things are just really weird and,
mm-hmm.
and off from reality. There's no real other way to explain it. The beginning of the movie, she gives her newborn child away to just someone, like, randomly. It's not like this, like, big deal. She's just like, hey, do you want my baby? And the lady's like, sure. And just, like, takes it. And that's the scene. It's just, like, it's got a lot of weird stuff like that. So what did you think about this movie?
I thought the movie was good. It's not something you usually see. Like, it's out of the ordinary, definitely.
For sure.
And even when it is out of the ordinary, you still had a little plot in it. Like,
yep.
The woman who gave her baby away, her life kind of got worse from there. And the woman who got the baby, her life got better
yeah.
from there.
Yeah, that is, like, that's, like, the inciting incident of, like, everything kind of going crazy.
Right.
After that, but there's more than just the baby. There's some other really weird scenes. About halfway through the movie, her child turns into a dog.
Julian?
Grandfather's purple heart. Julian, are you a dog now?
Julian, is that you?
It's him.
Yes.
And it's just a dog for the rest of the movie. Which was like, it's like, that's what you're gonna get from this movie, some really wacky, surreal stuff. And it has this weird tone where it's kind of funny, but also kind of, like, dark in a way.
Yes, yeah.
And it gets pretty dark, especially towards the end when things go off the rails.
Yes.
What did you think about, like, the comedy and the darkness to it?
They kind of had a balance.
Yeah, for sure.
But also didn't have a balance at the same time.
It's really hard to talk about, and it's really hard to put into words. You really kind of have to watch it. Did you have
yeah.
any scenes that you think, like, really stuck out to you?
the scene when the kids were playing on the soccer field and they turned into graves.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, what?
That's like one of the final moments of the movie, and we can talk about it because it's not really a spoiler. It doesn't.
No.
It just kind of happens. Like, the whole movie, these kids play soccer, and it's a normal soccer field.
Yeah.
And at the very end, the main character notices that there's grave markers on the soccer field. Mm-hmm. And the other character's like, oh, you never noticed that before? And it's just like, the movie never stops confusing you. And if you're into movies that are really weird and don't make a lot of sense, and you really have to, like, dig to find any semblance of meaning, you'll enjoy this. It's definitely an interesting watch. For sure. In preparation for this, when I was thinking of scenes, I was just like, just kept getting shocked by what happened. But to me, I think, like, it's hard to explain, but throughout the movie, there's like this stalker character,
mm-hmm.
who we get like POV shots of, like looking at other characters. And there's a moment where the stalker goes into the main character's house and pretends she's the main character and convinces the main character to leave her own house. And she just like, is in her house.
Yeah.
And it's just like, it's just so bizarre and bonkers. So that and her son turning into the dog were my favorite parts of the movie.
Yeah, that was pretty insane, the dog one.
Yeah, that was wild. That, because it comes out of nowhere.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the story up till then is like, we get a sense of like this family dynamic where like, there's these certain expectations pushed on the people in this society, and that's like bleeding over into the kids. And the kid isn't really meshing with it well. He's under a lot of pressure and doesn't really want to do the things the society asks of him.
Mm-hmm.
But the resolution of that is him turning into a dog. So yeah, it makes sense, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anything else about Greener Grass you wanted to talk about?
No.
No? No.
To be honest, I fell asleep during it. So I didn't watch the middle. Kind of middle, kind of end of it.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, it's not like there's not a lot of action in this movie.
Right.
It's just kind of weird thing after weird thing, that just gets increasingly more surreal. So you do have to like, it's a hard watch because there's not a traditional narrative to latch onto. There's not traditional characters to like connect with. You kind of just you just experience this movie. It just happens to you. And you just deal with the consequences.
Like, apparently I missed the part where the woman shoves a soccer ball up her dress.
Yes.
Was it a dress?
They're at a soccer game, and one of the women just, like, takes the soccer ball and, like, puts it up her dress, like,
yeah.
She and pretends she's pregnant with it. And for, like, the rest of the movie, she's, like, pretending to be pregnant, and then eventually she gives birth, and she has the soccer ball in, like, a little baby costume,
mm-hmm.
and everyone in the town just, like, just goes along with it. They're just like, oh, that's your new baby.
Yeah.
He's so cute. And it's just a soccer ball.
Like, when I woke up, the character answered the door to somebody. I forget who it was. And she had the soccer ball in, like, a baby carrier.
Yes.
And I was like, why did she have a soccer ball?
Oh, my God. Falling asleep during this movie.
I'm so confused.
The movie's already confusing enough. But that brings us to the question, would you recommend Greener Grass? Like, it's a very difficult question.
I think so.
You think so?
I mean,
I say definitely.
Yeah.
This is the type of movie
it's an independent film, so
it's an independent movie.
Yeah.
This is one of those movies that you watch to get a sense of how weird movies can be. So if you're into weird movies, if you're into stuff that doesn't make sense, I was getting like some David Lynch vibes at certain
mm-hmm.
points from this, like really surreal stuff. So if you're into stuff like that, I definitely recommend it. If you're more of a casual film fan,
if you're a casual film fan,
if you're more casually, probably not.
If you want something weird, just to like something out of the normal kind of video layout you are a movie layout you always see,
mm-hmm.
then yes, I'd recommend it.
Yeah, so that's Greener Grass. Thank you guys for watching The Bronx Box Office. We'll see you next episode for more of season 2, and we'll be watching documentaries. So.